In October 2024, an 1872 decided, rather awkwardly, to stop flying a bit early and landed short of the runway. So, why did this happen? Well, you would think the preliminary report would have some answers. It doesn't. In fact, it's the thinnest report I have seen in decades. You could fit it on the back of a napkin, with room left for your shopping list. And just to spice things up, it is sprinkled with so many factual errors, you start to wonder if anything in it is true. Buckle up, this one is going to be interesting. Hello aviators, how are you today? My name is Magnar Nordal, I am an ATAC captain and instructor. Today I'd like to talk what happens after a serious incident in commercial aviation. Whenever something significant occurs, an investigation is launched. And this leads to two reports. The first one is the preliminary report, which usually comes out about a month after the event. It includes basic facts, things like how many people were injured or killed, what kind of damage was done to the aircraft and surrounding areas, weather conditions, tracking data like ADS-B, and information from the flight data recorder, FDR. While this gives a good picture of what happened, it doesn't always explain why it happened. To get to the root cause, investigators had to dig deeper. They compare their flight data recorder data with the cockpit voice recorder, CVR, recordings and other sources. They interview the pilots. They also look into the human factors, the crew's training background and experience, and even the safety culture within the airline. Sometimes, identifying a technical fault requires going down to the microscopic level. Naturally, this takes time. Ideally, the final report is published within 12 months. But if the case is complex, it can take longer. The goal of this report is not to assign blame. It is to understand what went wrong and to suggest ways to prevent it from happening again. I bring this up because when a recent accident in India was covered by the Aviation Herald, I saw several comments attacking the aviation in India. That kind of negativity doesn't help anyone, and it definitely doesn't improve flight safety. So just a reminder, when you post a comment, you are speaking in a public space. Let's all show some respect. Today I want to talk about the preliminary report on a serious incident involving Allianz Air Flight 746, which landed short of the runway in Bhubaneswar, India, during heavy rain back in October 2024. Now, I have seen a lot of reports over the years, but this one is probably the shortest I have come across for a long time. Surprisingly, there is no information from the flight data recorder included, which is disappointing. Especially considering it took 6 months to release this report. And that's not all. There are some factual errors in the report itself, which raises questions about what you can actually trust in the text. Still, let's take a closer look and see what we can learn from it. Preliminary report, serious incident, to MS Allianz Air ATR-72 aircraft, Victor Tango, Romeo Kilo Foxtrot. At Bhubaneswar on 8 October 2024. General information. This is an ATR-72 operated by Allianz Air, a subsidiary of Air India. There were 43 passengers and 4 crew on board. The time of occurrence was 0850 UTC, which is 1420 local time. India time is UTC plus 5 hours and 30 minutes. Aircraft information. The aircraft had serial number 1423 and was manufactured in 1993. That's not correct. According to AirFleetsNet, this aircraft was an ATR-72-600, first flown in March 2017 and delivered to the company in August the same year. The aircraft, quote, is equipped with high wing with 27 meter span, twin turboprop engine configuration with Pratt & Whitney engine, serial number PW127M, and four propellers made by Hamilton Sundstrand. There are several errors here. The engines are two Pratt & Whitney Canada PW127M, which drive six-bladed propellers. I hope those errors will be corrected in the final report. Crew information. The first officer was rated on the ATR 72-600 in 2007. That doesn't make sense because the first 600 was delivered in 2011. Again, I hope this error will be corrected in the final report. Aerodrome information. The runway is long and runway 14 has ILS. The approach lights are 778 meters long, which means they comply with the requirement for full approach light system. False. Weather information. Time 0850 UTC. Light tailwind. Visibility 150 meters in heavy rain. The Aviation Herald provides the additional weather information. At 0830 UTC, the visibility was 4000 meters in haze. At 0900 UTC, the visibility was 500 meters in rain. The runway visual range at runway 14 was 600 meters. The trend forecast was temporary 350 meters visibility in heavy thunderstorm with rain. This clearly shows how rapidly the weather can change when you have tropical thunderstorms. Brief description of series incident. On October 8, 2024, aircraft Victor Tango Romeo Kilo Foxtrot operated a sector from Rourkela to Bhubaneswar with 43 passengers and 4 crew members on board. Prior to this flight, Victor Tango Romeo Kilo Foxtrot had completed 4 uneventful sorties. During the initial approach at 10 DME ILS, Bhubaneswar ATC instructed the aircraft to hold due to adverse weather conditions and traffic congestion at the Bhubaneswar airport. After briefing the crew on the weather conditions, which included heavy rain and a visibility of 800 meters, the aircraft was cleared to continue the approach on the ILS at 10 DME. Additionally, ATC instructed the crew to report the aircraft's position at 5 DME and then again at 4.8 DME. End quote. That last part doesn't quite make sense. At that stage on approach, the aircraft is usually flying at about 120 knots, covering 2 nautical miles per minute, so going from 5 DME to 4.8 would take just 6 seconds. Let's keep reading and see what else the report says. At 4.8 DME, Victor Tango Romeo Kilo Foxtrot cleared up for landing on runway 14. ATC also advised the crew that, in case of a go-around, shall execute a left turn towards a heading of 020, and the crew acknowledged the same, and up to 1000 feet, no rain was observed by the crew. The revised missed approach procedure actually makes sense. Unlike the published one, which sends you straight back towards the airport and could interfere with other traffic. For the ILS approach to runway 14, the minimum descent altitude is 215 feet above the runway threshold, and you need at least 550 meters visibility. In this case, the reported visibility was 800 meters, so the crew was well within limits to begin the approach. However, as the aircraft neared the minimums, the crew encountered heavy rain, but approach lights became visible. The crew requested ATC to increase the intensity of the approach lights for runway 14, and this request was promptly done by ATC. The aircraft continued to approach and was at the final approach at 0850 UTC. The crew felt the aircraft sink and experienced unusual vibrations inside the cockpit, just as it was approaching the runway 14 threshold. At this point, the aircraft hits one Cat 1 approach light and four Cat 2 approach lights before making its touchdown 43.5 meters short of the edge of runway 14. After landing, the aircraft cleared up to park at stand 2. Meanwhile, an outbound flight AXB-1327, a Boeing 737-800, which was holding at the holding point for runway 14 at Taxiway Juliet, reported FOD on the runway 14. That means objects on the runway. This led to the cancellation of the Opens flight's takeoff clearance. At 0907, the pilot in command on Victor Tango Romeo Kilo Foxtrot reported to ATC via landline that there was a suspected tail strike during the landing. There were no injuries to any occupants on board and no fire occurred. The damage to the aircraft is listed on the last page in the report. When the report mentions that the crew felt the aircraft was sinking, my first thought was, could it have been a microburst? There could be other explanations too, which I will get into later. But let's start with what a microburst actually is. A microburst is a column of rapidly descending air within a thunderstorm. When this downburst hits the ground, it spreads out in all directions, creating sudden and intense wind shear. Surface wind speeds can exceed 100 knots. Most microbursts are triggered by heavy rainfall, and they are short-lived, typically lasting just 5 to 15 minutes, which makes them extremely difficult to predict. I personally experienced microbursts twice. The first time was at Mamigili Airport in the Maldives while we were preparing for departure. From the cockpit, we saw a wall of rain racing towards us. The wind picked up, reaching at least 70 knots. In fact, the airport's wind meter maxed out at 70 knots and failed. Tons of sand were blown across the apron, which ended up looking more like a beach. Fortunately, the aircraft wasn't damaged, but it took 3 days to clear all the sand from the apron. The second time I experienced a microburst was on approach to Bangkok Suvarnabhumi Airport at night. We were following an Airbus A320. The whole airport was clearly visible until suddenly the runway lights faded out. We could still see the approach lights, the terminal, and the parallel runway. But directly ahead of us was total darkness. The weather radar showed a small but intense echo forming right over the runway threshold. The Airbus ahead of us vanished into the dark patch, and we watched it on the TCAS. Just a few hundred feet above the runway, it began climbing again. The crew reported a missed approach due to wind shear. At that point, we were stable on the ILS at about 1500 feet. I called for a go-around and asked the tower for a heading to steer us clear of the cell. We landed safely on the parallel runway about 10 minutes later.
100. 50. 40. 30. 20, 10.
Modern airliners are equipped with a predictive wind shear alert system, PWS, which gives the crew an early warning so they can initiate an escape maneuver in time. Until recently, the ATR didn't have this system, but now the newest ATR models can be delivered with this system installed. A welcome safety upgrade. Another key factor in this incident was the heavy rain. I have landed in similar conditions, specifically in 1000 meters visibility during a consistent downpour that lasted over 20 minutes, so no microburst. We were flying an ILS with a 200 foot decision height. At around 400 feet, we caught sight of the first approach lights. By the time we reached minima, the runway end became visible. I kept the autopilot engaged until 160 feet, which is the minimum autopilot connection height. That's when the puppy lights finally become visible. One of the big challenges in these situations is visibility through the windscreen. The wipers just aren't effective enough in heavy rain, and that leads to significant distortion, especially at night, which can be very disorienting. It's slightly better during daylight, but still not ideal. According to the preliminary report on the Alliance Air incident, visibility at the time of the landing was only 150 meters. Whether that number is accurate is hard to say, especially since the report contains multiple factual errors. Now, unless you have been specifically trained for Category 2 ILS approaches, you may not have experienced what it is like to lose visual contact when you are below minima. During Category 2 simulator training, one of the key lessons is to go around if you lose visual reference, even if that means you might perform a touch and go. That muscle memory is critical, but without that training, there's a real psychological pressure to land once you pass minima. That's why the standard call-out at decision height when you are visual should always be continue. If you call landing, you may create a mental block against going around, even if that's the safer option. Poor visibility can also contribute to another serious risk, the duck under syndrome. The duck under syndrome happens when a pilot, during an instrument approach in poor visibility, especially at night or in fog, unintentionally lowers the nose of the aircraft to try to see the runway sooner. This causes the aircraft to drop below the published glide path, making it an unstable approach and increasing the risk for controlled flight into terrain. To the other pilot, this sudden pitch change can feel like the aircraft is sinking, which can create confusion and concern if not properly communicated. There are several contributing factors to watch out for. Visual illusions. The runway may appear lower than it actually is. Pressure to land. Time, fuel, or operation stress can push pilots to make it work. Altitude misjudgment. Poor visibility can make it difficult to accurately sense altitude. Fatigue or over-reliance on visual cues, especially late in the day or on long sectors. In poor visibility, it's essential that the pilot monitoring stays focused on the instruments all the way to touchdown. Their job is to guard against any unintentional deviation from the glide path. The pilot flying will typically begin looking outside about 100 feet above minima. If pilot flying starts to acquire visual references before reaching decision height, the decision can be made to continue the approach when reaching minima. So at the minima call, the decision is already made to go around or continue. As I mentioned at the beginning of this video, the facts in this case are limited and the report contains several errors, which makes it hard to know what's accurate and what's not. We don't know the airspeed, the altitude, the rate of descent, the flight path, the power settings, the control inputs, when the autopilot was disconnected, and even who was flying. We also don't know who was looking where, what was said or not said in those critical moments. What we do know is this: it was raining and the aircraft landed short of the runway. As for why it happened, that's for the investigators to determine. And that is all for this time. As always, a big shout out to my supporters. They saw this video 2 days before you. Thank you for watching. Have a wonderful day and happy learning.